The Bible records many stories of people who were despised by other people but were highly esteemed in God's sight. And the Bible also records many other stories of people that were highly esteemed in their generation but were despised in God's sight. Especially are we surprised to find out that oftentimes the most highly religious people were despised by God. Why is this? Stay tuned, we'll find out.
Welcome to Steps to Life with Dr. John Grossbaugh.
Sabbath rest is a promise between God and His children.
Bible prophecy tells us that we are living in the last days of this earth's history before Jesus' second coming. Today's program will help you prepare for these coming events. Stay tuned.
Thanks for joining us. We live in a world today where many people do not really know what love is. People mistake sexual passion for love, but those are two different things. People don't know what real love is, and we cannot go to heaven if we do not love God with all of our heart, soul, and mind, and our neighbor as ourself. But we're going to study a story in a few minutes that will explain and help us understand what real love is. Before we do that, let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we read in His holy book. Father in heaven, we thank You for Jesus. We thank You for the love that You have poured out upon this world by sending Your only begotten Son to die on the cross to save us from the penalty of sin and to restore us and give us the opportunity, each one of us, to have everlasting life. Help us to understand what we need to do to receive that precious gift. We pray in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen.
Today's free book is entitled Somebody Cares. To receive your free copy, simply call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer IM79. Did you know there is someone who cares for you with a love that is stronger than any earthly bond? Someone who wants to be your constant companion and closest friend? Who is this person and how can you get to know him? To find out, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788 and ask for your free copy of Somebody Cares.
In John, the 12th chapter, we read that 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany. Now, this was in 31 AD, 6 days before the crucifixion. Jesus comes to Bethany. Bethany was slightly less than 2 miles from Jerusalem. It says that, of course, that's where Lazarus lived and his two sisters, Martha and Mary, in Bethany. It says then in John, the 12th chapter, that they made him a supper there, and Martha served, and Lazarus was sitting at the table, and Mary was there also, listening to every word that Jesus spoke. Actually, if we go to the Gospel of Mark tells us who it was that made this supper. It says in Mark 14, verse 3, it says, "And being in Bethany at the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at the table, a woman came." So he was at the house of Simon the leper. Simon, of course, was a Pharisee. He was one of the few Pharisees who was accounted as a follower of Jesus. And he looked upon Jesus as a prophet, a wonderful man. Of course, Jesus had healed Simon from leprosy, a living death. So he had some reason to admire Jesus. However, he did not look upon Jesus as the Savior of the world or as the Messiah. And he had not accepted Him, therefore, as the Savior. His character was not changed. And at this supper, some very interesting things began to develop. Because if we read on in Mark, the 14th chapter, it says, "As he sat at the table, a woman came having an alabaster flask of very costly oil of spikenard, and she broke the flask and poured it on his head." Now, most of the Gospels, this story is recorded in the different Gospels in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, but most of the Gospels don't tell you who this woman was. But the Gospel of John was one of the last books of the New Testament to be written. It was probably, almost for sure, written long after the death of Mary. And John felt free to tell you exactly who this woman was, although the other writers don't say who it was. It says here in John the 12th chapter, "Then Mary took a pound of very costly oil of spikenard, anointed the feet of Jesus, and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of the oil." Mary had been a terrible sinner. She had been in prostitution, and her mind had been controlled by demons. She was what we would call a demon-possessed person or woman. But Jesus had cast the demons out of her mind. Jesus had forgiven her sins and shown her a new way to live, a way to live a pure life. And Mary was very grateful for what Jesus had done for her. Her sins had been forgiven. She was given a second chance. There are a lot of people in the world that need a second chance or a third chance. Mary was given actually seven chances. We read in the Bible that Jesus cast seven demons out of her. In other words, he cast demons out of her seven times. A lot of people would have given up on somebody before that. But because Jesus had had incredible mercy upon her and forgiven her sins and cast the demons out of her mind over and over again, she was very grateful. She wanted some way to show her gratitude. And so she had heard Jesus talk about the fact of his coming death. And she thought, well, if he's going to die, I need to do something to, I need to get some ointment so that when he dies, I can anoint his body. And so at great personal sacrifice, she had bought this box, this alabaster box of ointment, oil of nard. And this, of course, cost about the equivalent of 10 months' wages for a working man. She had this ready to anoint the body of Jesus when he died, but now she was hearing all the talk. The disciples were excited. This was on Saturday night when this supper was given, just before the triumphal entry into Jerusalem the next day on Sunday. And she heard everybody talking about the fact they expected Jesus to be crowned king. And she thought, well, that would be wonderful. That sounded much more wonderful than his death. And she thought, if he's going to be crowned king, I would like to be the first to honor him. And so she broke the box and she put it on his head, on his feet. And then she knelt down weeping and moistened with her tears. She wiped off the ointment off his feet. And she had tried to do this without being observed as much as possible. But this ointment filled The fragrance of this ointment filled the whole house. So everybody knew what had happened. And Judas, in particular, was greatly displeased. Now, the synoptic gospels, the first three gospels, just tell you about the disciples talking against what Mary had done and severely criticizing her. But the Apostle John, again, writing approximately 100 A.D., his gospel, he tells you exactly who it was that stirred up this criticism of Mary. He says here in John the 12th chapter, he says, "Then one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, who would betray him, said, 'Why was this fragrant oil not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor?' This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had the money box, and he used to take what was put in it." So Jesus had a treasure. Even among his disciples, he had a treasure who was dishonest, who was a thief. Now, Mary was trembling. She was afraid she was going to get openly reproached by Christ for her extravagance. That was the talk that was going around. They were criticizing her. It says here in Mark the 14th chapter, it says that the disciples, they said, it might have been sold for more than 300 denarii and given to the poor, and they criticized her sharply. She was embarrassed. She was afraid that Christ himself might rebuke her. And so she was also afraid that her sister Martha would rebuke her for extravagance. Martha, of course, was a good manager, probably a much better manager than Mary. They had a completely different temperament. She was embarrassed and distressed. She was about to just slink away and disappear. But Jesus knew everything that was going on, like he always does. And he responded to this criticism. We see here in Mark, the 14th chapter, starting with the 6th verse, it says, "But Jesus said, 'Let her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has done a good work for me. For you have the poor with you always, and whenever you wish, you may do them good. But me you do not have always. She has done what she could. She has come beforehand to anoint my body for burial. Assuredly, I say to you, wherever this gospel is preached throughout the whole world, what this woman did will also be spoken of as a memorial of her.'" This is a fascinating story. If you study about oil of nard, when you put oil of nard, that is an extremely potent perfume. When you put that ointment on somebody's skin, it doesn't just disappear. That fragrance stays there for weeks. When Jesus went down into his great trial in the Garden of Gethsemane, and when he was crucified on the cross, during that whole time, he could smell that fragrance of that oil. He knew that there was somebody in the world that loved him for what he had done for them. It was like a down payment, an earnest of the love that he knew that he would have from all of his redeemed ones through eternal ages. There are many people, even today, when someone dies, they bring precious gifts. And as they stand about a cold, silent form of a dead person, they speak words of love freely. They express tenderness and appreciation and devotion for a person that can't see, can't hear, can't feel, doesn't know anything, who is, as the Bible says, asleep. How wonderful it would be if we wouldn't wait until one of our loved ones dies before we tell them how much we love them, how much we appreciate them, how tender we feel in regard to them. Mary didn't know the real significance of what she was doing, but the Holy Spirit planned for her. She couldn't answer her accusers, but inspiration doesn't stoop to give any reason. The Lord knows what's going on. And an unseen presence had spoken to her mind and soul, and she had followed the impression of the Holy Spirit. And Christ told Mary the meaning of what she had done. He said, "In that she has poured this ointment on my body, she did it to prepare me, to anoint me beforehand for burial." Wasn't it wonderful that the fragrance of her love could be felt by Christ while he was still alive? Now, there were other people like Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus. They brought 100 Roman pounds of spices to anoint Jesus after he died. And then there were those that came Sunday morning that were going to bring more spices to anoint him, but it was too late. He'd already risen. But Mary anointed his body when he could still feel and smell and realize the strength and depth of her devotion. Jesus said on this occasion, he said, "Wherever the gospel shall be preached in the whole world, there shall also this that this woman has done be told for a memorial of her." As we look down through the ages, we see that hearts over and over again, millions of times, have been blessed through her unstudied act. The fragrance of what she has done has come right down to our time. Now, kingdoms would rise and fall. Generals and conquerors and kings and presidents would be forgotten. But what this woman did,
is immortalized upon the pages of sacred history, and as long as time will last, that broken alabaster box will tell the story of the abundant love of God for a fallen race. Now, Mary's act was in marked contrast to Judas. We just read in John, the 12th chapter, verses 4 to 6, that Judas said, well, this could have been sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor. And he said that not because the poor would have received it, because he would have stolen part of it. Jesus could have made very clear what Judas' motives were. He might have caused indignation to be excited against Judas for his hypocrisy. But if he had done that, even though Judas would have been exposed, like so often happens when the criminal is exposed, even though he's exposed, he gains sympathy. So Jesus did not expose Judas. He just looked at him. Judas knew that Christ understood his base, contemptible character and his hypocrisy and all about it. But Jesus didn't say anything. Prior to this time, Jesus had never rebuked Judas. And even this time, he didn't say anything against Judas per se. He only commended Mary when Judas had tried to rebuke her. Now, the rest of the disciples were not like Judas. They didn't really understand what was going on. But they did not appreciate the exalted character of Jesus. They didn't understand, it seems, that Christ values acts of heartfelt courtesy. He appreciated, and he still appreciates, acts of love and service from those who follow him, those that he has redeemed. This ointment that Mary put upon the head of Jesus and on his feet was a symbol of the love that was in her heart. It was an outward demonstration of the love that was fed by heavenly streams until it overflowed. This act of Mary was just the lesson that the disciples needed to show them that love to Christ that was expressed was pleasing in his sight. Later on, the disciples felt like sheep without a shepherd. In just a few days, he was going to be gone. He was going to die on the cross. And when they took his body down from the cross, they felt keenly the rebuke of Christ and commending what Mary had done when they had been criticizing, thinking that the poor were of more value than Christ. After that, they didn't cast the blame on Mary anymore. They cast the blame on themselves. How could they ever think that the poor were more worthy than Christ? The same want of understanding exists in the world today. There are few people that really appreciate all that Jesus is to them. If they did, the great love of Mary would be more often expressed. Nothing would be thought too costly to give to Christ. There would be no self-denials, no self-sacrifice that was thought to be too much to be endured for his sake. The disciple said, Judas said, why is this waste? To what purpose is this waste? That statement brought vividly to the mind of Christ the greatest sacrifice that had ever been made, the sacrifice of all heaven being poured out in one give to save a fallen world. It could not be said concerning the God of heaven that he could do more. God gave all of heaven. But from a human point of view, it would seem that this sacrifice is wanton waste. How is it that there's so much waste of mercies and resources, and there's so few people that seem to accept the gospel? But the atonement for a fallen world, a lost world, was to be full and complete and abundant, so that it could reach every soul that God created. Every person will not be saved, but every person could be saved if they chose. Well, Simon was looking on all of this, and Simon had some very different thoughts too. Simon wasn't thinking exactly the same thing that Judas was thinking. He was thinking something maybe a little bit worse. We'll look at Simon next.
Sometimes studying the Bible on your own, without any help or guideline to follow, can be a little difficult. And after confusion and frustration set in, we all too often turn to other things. If this sounds like you, you're not alone. The Steps to Life Bible Correspondence School is just the answer. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for your free Bible Correspondence Starter Pack.
I really enjoy being able to study at home. I'm a new Christian, and I definitely knew I needed some guidance.
Simply review each lesson and answer the questions.
These studies were great. It just seemed like the Bible opened up for me.
Then send the completed lesson back to us in the envelope provided.
These studies were very professional. They didn't take a lot of time, and I really appreciated that.
A Bible teacher will then look over each lesson and send them back to you with the next set of studies. It's that simple and totally free. Call Steps to Life Television at 1-800-THE-TRUTH.
I'm so glad I called.
Welcome back. We read this same story in the Gospel of Luke from a completely different angle. Luke talks about some details that the rest of the Gospel writers don't even mention. This is the way Luke relates it in Luke 7, starting with verse 36. It says, "Then one of the Pharisees asked him to eat with him, and he went to the Pharisee's house and sat down to eat. And behold, a woman in the city who was a sinner," that was Mary, "when she knew that Jesus sat at the table in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of fragrant oil, and stood at his feet behind him weeping. And she began to wash his feet with her tears, and wiped them with the hair of her head, and she kissed his feet, and anointed them with the fragrant oil. Now when the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he spoke to himself." In other words, he said silently, "This man, if he were a prophet, would know who and what manner of woman this is who is touching him, for she is a sinner." Now, Jesus had cured Simon of leprosy, of a living death. But now Simon is questioning whether Jesus is even a prophet or not, because he's saying to himself, he's a Pharisee, he says, if Jesus knew who this woman was, certainly he wouldn't even allow her to touch him. She's been in prostitution. Well, nothing was said. But now we see Jesus could read the heart. He knew what people were thinking. And so now Jesus is going to respond to Simon's unspoken thought. And we read now, starting in verse 40, it says, "And Jesus answered and said to him, Simon, I have something to say to you. And he said, Teacher, say it. There was a certain creditor who had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii, and the other 50. And when they had nothing with which to pay, he freely forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them will love him the more?" Simon answered and said, "I suppose the one whom he forgave more." And he said to him, "You have rightly judged." Simon didn't know. He had just walked into a trap that Jesus had set up for him. He had pronounced judgment on himself, and he didn't know it. Just like when Nathan came to David, he stated the case in the terms of a parable, and David pronounced judgment on himself and said that that man was worthy to die, and he was talking about himself. This woman had been deeply wronged by Simon. And now he is considering that Jesus shouldn't even allow her to touch him. He actually was more guilty than she was. So often that's the case. The people that we think are really guilty are not even as guilty as we are. Now both Simon and this woman owed an infinite debt to Jesus. Jesus had saved Simon from leprosy, a living death. He had saved this woman from her guilt that she had been involved in prostitution, and he had saved her from the demons that controlled her mind. So each of them owed Jesus a debt of gratitude. But only Mary really had the gratitude. Simon was critical of Jesus, wondering whether he was even a prophet. So Jesus is going to explain the story to Simon now. Simon has told him who would love him the more. Now Jesus, with delicate kindness, but very plainly, is going to explain something to Simon. And he says, starting in verse 44, "Then he turned to the woman and said to Simon, 'Do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has washed my feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head. You gave me no kiss, but this woman has not ceased to kiss my feet since the time I came in. You did not anoint my head with oil, but this woman has anointed my feet with fragrant oil. Therefore, I say to you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But to whom little is forgiven, the same loves little.' And he said to her, 'Your sins are forgiven.'" Simon was in a state of shock. All of a sudden, he began to see himself in a totally new light. He saw that Mary was a sinner who was forgiven, but he saw that he was a sinner who was not forgiven. Christ recounted the opportunities that Simon had had to show his love and appreciation for what he had received from his divine master. He thought he had been reading his guest, but his guest had been reading him. He saw how true Christ's judgment of his character was. His religion had been a robe of Phariseeism. He had despised the compassion of Jesus. Now he saw that Mary was a sinner who was forgiven. He was a sinner that was unforgiven. And yet he was touched by the kindness of Jesus, that Jesus had not pointed out to everybody his character. He had just tried to make a true statement of the case to help him to see what his real situation was. The result was that Simon saw the magnitude of what he owed to Jesus. He thought he wasn't even a prophet, but Jesus read his mind and stated to him the real state of his character. Oh, friend, Jesus knows your character. He knows if you, like Mary, have a mind that is possessed by demons. He knows what your sins are, what your guilt is. He would like to forgive you. He would like to set you free from the bondage, the guilt, and the cruelty of sin, like he did for Mary. Jesus knows your circumstances. He knows the circumstances of every human being. You might say, "Well, I'm sinful. I'm very sinful." Well, Mary was very sinful. But if you come to Jesus and choose to confess your sins to Him, to follow Him, He won't turn you away. He won't tell you everything that He could tell you. But He will forgive you and set you on the narrow road that leads to the kingdom of God. Start you off in the road that leads to righteousness and holy living. Jesus will lift you up above the strife and the accusing of tongues. He said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." Jesus wants to say that to you too, if you will repent and confess and choose to follow Him today.
Today's free book is entitled, Somebody Cares. To receive your free copy, simply call 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788 and ask for offer IM79. Many people today are battling with loneliness, depression, or discouragement. There seems to be no hope for the future and only darkness on the horizon. But there is hope. There is somebody who cares, somebody who truly does have a personal concern for you and wants to be to you closer than a brother. Isaiah the prophet says concerning him, "Surely he has bore our griefs and carried our sorrows, and the chastisement of our peace was upon him." Who is this person and what can he do for you? To find out how you can receive your free copy of Somebody Cares, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788 and ask for offer IM79. Call now.
Steps to Life.
We hope you have been as blessed by today's message as we have been in bringing it to you. We encourage you to contact us at Steps to Life Television with any questions or comments you might have.
Check 1-2. Check 1-2.
Don't forget to ask for today's free offer.
Ready in 5.
Steps to Life Television, a ministry preparing a people for the soon coming of Jesus Christ.
Welcome, friends.
He can change your life.